we have to make the data available in SDFS. First, get the data to
Correct.
the Hadoop cluster, then after that, try to perform or try to write the jobs or so whatever you want to do, process it through MapReduce, or you can process it through Yarn. Right. So what is writing the MapReduce? See, writing a map, suppose when I've started, so I'm writing a MapReduce program. One of my friend, he asked me, Ajay, can you write a MapReduce program? Then I wrote a program in C language. Then no, you should write a MapReduce. Then I wrote a program in C++. No, again he's saying that write a MapReduce program. Then I simply said, yes, Mr. my dear friend, please write a oops program. Then again he's writing C language. No, then I said, no, not C language, write oops. No, then that's the concept here. So MapReduce is a concept. So where we are going to write this in a MapReduce supported languages, but not MapReduce is a not a programming. It's a oops. It's like the same way we have a MapReduce where we are going to implement this MapReduce in the languages like C language, C++, and Hive are the big, right? Python, Java. So you can use any thing to write the MapReduce. And
I have one doubt. Like in MapReduce, but only Java and Python are used.
no.
Can we use C and C++ as well?
Yes, right. We can write
Okay.
this in the MapReduce, right? But it's right now, so the MapReduce is going to be completely depreciated. So soon, actually, we don't have this concept of MapReduce in the coming days in the Hadoop, because it's right. So, right as of now, see, we can see we can able to run these things in the Yarn, which are the
Correct.
non-MapReduce jobs, which we can able to
Correct.
write.
Big and
Okay.
high.
Not Pig and Hive. So it's a Yarn. Yarn stands for it another resource negotiated,
Correct, correct.
which is a non-MapReduce. That is now before 2.0 in the Hadoop, we should be able to write the MapReduce jobs where your data is in SDFS. But in after Hadoop 2.0 onwards, we are going to write the non-MapReduce jobs where your input data is in SDFS. Okay, so it's right now the 2.7.0, so the maximum MapReduce priority will be depreciated, and so in the coming days soon in the 2016, so maybe we never will have this word MapReduce in the Hadoop.
I think the Spark is we are using
Yes,
and
we are
RDD, Relay
using
Distributed.
Spark, and so apart from that, we are mostly relying on the SQL engine, so that it will be the coding part in the simpler, like you can use Spark SQL, you can use Impala,
Nice part.
Teza, you can use Tej, you can use, right, so Hive, Beeline, Beeswax. So we are getting the multiple tools or the components which is really done SQL engine. Okay, so that's now the so Hadoop is a combination of SDFS. That is, now see, when we configure the Hadoop, so we'll take the bunch of disks. So this your admin will configure this bunch of disks as a nodes, and we are calling these nodes as the data nodes, right? So where we are storing the data, actual data, right? The data which you are going to process, right? So we are calling these are the data nodes. Right now, see this file info, prod info dot prod info, the file you're going to write into the three data nodes, right? Similarly, we'll write multiple files into the data nodes, right? But when you're going to write the multiple files into the data node, then how you identify which file is written into which data node, right? Suppose I have given a textbook of 1 lakh pages. I have given
Correct.
a textbook of 1 lakh pages. There is no indexes there, and I told you to pick one paragraph, not the topic. I told you to pick one paragraph. How much difficult it is picking a one paragraph from the 1 lakh pages of textbook, right? It's possible, but it's a lot of difficult, right? You need to spend a lot of time. The same thing now when we are going to write the data into these data nodes. So sometimes maybe we go have with a 100 node cluster to 3000, 2000 node cluster where we are having multiple files are written into the data nodes, right? So we are taking some extra node. That we calling it as a name node, right? So where we are writing the reference index of the data to the data nodes, right? So what we have in this data nodes, which file is written into the data nodes. So that will be written into the name node. That is, suppose I'm going to write a file like you know this command, right? I think Hadoop fs-put is a file.
Put, yeah.
Right. So I'm writing the file prod underscore info to the directory usr and then cloud-a-ram. Okay, so I'm going to create a directory here, Ajay. In the Ajay directory, there is a subdirectory prod. So now I'm going to copy this file to this place, right?
Okay.
Now, so when you write this command, what happens now? The file, the content of the product underscore info is written to the data nodes. The actual content is distributed into the small size of chunks based upon the block size that will be written into the data nodes. And this reference, so where you have this file, is written into the name node.
Okay.
Right. So what a name node contains? Name node contains metadata. Name node contains index of the data, or you can say a reference of the data in a data node. And the actual data is written into the data nodes.
Yeah. Okay.
So that is when you're going to write the data. So now this SDFS. So whenever you install Hadoop, suppose see what I did, have my operating system is available, right? So we can able to configure Hadoop in Windows as well as we can able to configure Hadoop in Linux. Right, suppose you can use a Windows or you can use Linux to configure the Hadoop. Okay,
but Hadoop is a Linux based system, no?
Yes, Hadoop is natively supports Linux, but we can able to configure Hadoop in Windows.
Windows, yes, okay.
Right, because we can see a dedicated Hadoop distribution from the Microsoft coming days. As of now, for the Microsoft using Windows in the Hadoop, and it's available. There are the projects are going on. So it's a, okay. Because they are using SD Azure for their cloud. So it's a SD Insight is a one component in the Hadoop. So where we can able to work with the Hadoop in Windows, right? So we'll see those things later, right? So we have an operating system is available now. So first in this disk, so this is a disk, okay? So now in this disk, I have installed this operating system. On top of this, I have installed a Hadoop, right? So if you are using a Windows, means we are having a file system that you can say NTFSR FAT file system, right? And the top of this Windows are the Linux file system. So we install Hadoop. So when you install Hadoop, so here we'll get the file system, SDFS file system, right? So now when, so we'll have the two file systems. So now we can say that this file system, which we have worked, which we are working with the Windows or the Linux, is a local file system. Okay, so this is this we call it as a local file system, and this file which we are working is a SDFS file system, and then we can able to copy a file from the local to SDFS as well as SDFS to local, right? Both the things, right? So that is we can work with the both the ways, local to SDFS and SDFS to local file system, right? So now here what we are saying, right? So here this is a now we can able to copy a file to the SDFS file system. When you run the command Hadoop space fs-fn put command, so this file is available locally, right? To copy to the SDFS file system. When the file is copied to the SDFS file system, the file is copied, but where it copied, we don't know. Right, even nobody knows, right? It's available in the cluster somewhere in the data nodes, right? How it will be, it's a simple calculation. Suppose you're going to write this file, correct? The file size is 1000 MB is the file size, okay? So in a, you have defined that you're using the each block size is 64 MB, right? Suppose we have a property that is dfs.block is a property which is defined as 64 MB, Okay, so that means in a file SDFS hyphen site.xml is a configuration file. So where yes, where we are having this property 64 MB, right? That is now the total file is 1000 divided by 64 is something 15.6. That is total 16 blocks are going to be created. Right, 16 blocks in the sense the blocks are from block 1, block 2 to block 16. Right, so here what is the rule? So all blocks are same size except the last block, because last block is filled only the 0.6 percentage. Right, so 64 by 6 is like some 14 MB if you date. 50 MB some last block size is okay. So all blocks are same size except the last block, right? Now so 16 blocks are going to be created. So after that, so we are using the replication, right? So what is a replication? Now so the replication is replicating the data, that is duplicating the data. Why we have to replicate?
To store so that one node fails, so other can we can have a backup from the other node.
Not exactly, not the backup. So the replication is like, see, we are using the commodity hardware. So commodity hardware in the sense the data it's going to be down at any time. So we can expect the failure every day. One node is going to be down. So that so we are going to write multiple copies of the data because we have a concept JBOD. Right.
Yeah.
Now we are making multiple copies of the data into multiple disks so that to make the cluster available 24/7. I don't want to down the cluster for every small reason. So even if you go one node goes down, right? Fine, no issue, right? Because the same block is available. That is your replication is three, means each block is replicated three times. That three is times. There are three block ones are available.
Yeah.
Okay, like so there are three block twos are available. Okay, so all these blocks are equally distributed to the all the data nodes, right? So when these blocks are distributed, so they will follow a policy, that is block replication placement policy. Okay, based upon this policy the blocks are going to be replicated. So we'll see this policy in the architecture session when we are discussing about. Okay, so based upon this block replication placement policy, all these blocks are going to be replicated and then distributed to the data nodes. Okay, so that so we'll get some block one in this data node one, so block two is available in this disk two of the data node two, so some block one is written into data node three, so that all the 48 blocks are equally distributed to the Hadoop the data nodes. Okay, now see, we get we have the data and we have the blocks in each SDFS, right? Okay, so we have the blocks are available.
Correct.
Now so a file, a complete file is a combination of all its blocks.
All blocks.
Right? Not one block, two blocks. So whenever you write a cat command, then what it has to do, it has to get the all the blocks and it has to give the complete data, not only some specific block data.
Correct.
When it has to display the complete blocks of the data, so how it will identify from where it will get the blocks, right? So that's the reason we have a name node. So actual data is written into the SDFS and the reference of the data is written into the name node. So now you have a client application, or a client is trying to write a program in C language or C++ or Hive, anything. Suppose we'll take a simple program. So he entered something, select count of star, right? So we have create table count of star from, right? So prod info.
Yeah.
okay, he run a query, right? So when he entered this query, he whenever he pressed the enter button, now immediately who comes into the picture?
Job
Yes,
job
job
kit.
tracker, right? So job tracker generally resides in the name node. Okay, job tracker resides in the name node. Now, so it takes the request from the client,
client,
and then what it has to do, it has to check in the name node that where this prod info is available to count the records. Then it goes to that particular data node. In each data node we'll have a task tracker.
Correct.
Okay, then it will assign the job to the task tracker.
Correct.
Okay, then the task tracker will execute the job. Right, job tracker assign the job to the task tracker. Task tracker will execute the job. As long as the task tracker is executing the job, job tracker is waiting for the output from the task tracker.
Task
so
trackers.
That the task tracker is saying that, yes, please, I'm working, please wait. It will send the heartbeats continuously. So as long as it is working, it will send the heartbeats. Once the job is completed, it will give the output back to the job tracker. Then the job tracker will give it back to the client, right?
Client.
Right. So this is how your query is going to be processed. Now here, when the job is working fine, perfect data node, it's okay. Suppose if the data node goes down, suppose job completed 99%, then the job tracker goes, data node goes down. Correct. So we have the different issues. So here what you have to identify. So the job tracker is doing what? Taking a request, going to the name node, and getting the reference, then going to the data nodes. And then here in the data nodes, it will identify the blocks, and it is assigning the job to the task tracker, and it is waiting the response from the task tracker. And after that, it will give the output back to the job tracker, because only one job tracker is doing this many number of jobs. So that
correct,
once finished this job, remaining jobs are in a queue line, pipeline. So you run multiple commands, right? Select the count to start from prod info. And I wrote another program. Otherwise, I wrote a join statement, right? Where I have to run multiple queries are there. So until you
correct.
Finish one, other things are in a queue, right? So,
correct.
Right. So now what we did here. Okay, so now the blocks are placed like this. The reference are written into the name node, and we have the job tracker resides in the name node. Correct. So after that, so the issue, because job tracker has to do all the things, so other jobs are should be in a pipeline, right? So the job tracker role, right? Previously, job tracker is a one employee. Right now, so they have recruited two employees instead of the job tracker. The same job role will be given to the two employees, right? One is a resource manager. Okay, and other one is a node manager. Okay, now node manager is a task tracker, like a task tracker. Resource manager is like a job tracker. So we have the two employees here, resource manager and application master. These two people work together now. So the previously task to the entire job is done by the only one employee now. So the same job is done by the two employees. So where the difference comes now, when two people are working with the same job,
performance will increase.
Yeah, because we can able to run process multiple jobs.
Process multiple
right?
jobs, yeah.
So because once the job is entered by, suppose you enter the select count of star from the table name. First, the job takes the resource manager, then it will identify the resources, then job will be given to the application master to run the job. Now, with the job, application master is one running. Then, in simultaneously, now resource manager can able to take another request, right? Until resource manager allocating the resources to the job, then application master may finish the existing job, right? Now it can able to take the second request from the resource manager. Now application master is working with the second job, then resource manager can able to take the third request from the client, means now you can able to process multiple
Multiple
jobs
jobs at the same
simultaneously,
time.
right? So
Correct,
this
correct.
is right. So in the Hadoop before 2.0, we used to have job tracker. So what are the Hadoop daemons now before 2.0? Name node,
Name node, DFS.
data nodes,
Okay.
and secondly name node, and then we have a job tracker, okay, and it is a task tracker,
Task tracker. Yeah, correct.
okay. So these are the Hadoop before 2.0. So then in the Hadoop after 2.0, we have a name node, we'll have
Yeah,
then
correct.
we have a data nodes, have a secondly name node. Now instead of the job tracker, we'll have
Yarn is a
we'll
source
have
manager.
the yard, that is we are going to have resource manager and application master for the job tracker role, and node manager for the
Node
task
manager.
tracker,
Task taker.
right? So this is Hadoop after 2.0.
Okay.
Right, so these are the Hadoop daemons, Hadoop before
2.0.
2.0. Now got it? So actually Hadoop architecture, if you go through this diagram, it can be in the sense of master and slaves.
Master and slaves, yeah, true.
Correct? So here the name node is a master, and all the data nodes are the slaves. Correct. So fine, first see here, right? So these are the Hadoop before 2.0, and these are the Hadoop after 2.0 onwards. Now in the Hadoop after 2.0, if you want to use a job tracker, yes, you can use. Otherwise, if you want to use a resource manager and application master, yes, you can. It's your choice, either you want to go with the job tracker or the Yarn. But in Hadoop before 2.0, so you don't have Yarn available, so you have to go through only a job tracker. But here it's your choice. You want to write a job with a MapReduce or without a MapReduce, it's up to you. Okay, in the Hadoop after 2.0 onwards. Got it? So the same thing, so if we say like this, we can also write Hadoop daemons are distributed into master and
slave.
Slave architecture. Right, so what are the masters now?
Name node and yarn.
Right.
After
right. Correct. So again, so in it's a different in the Hadoop before 2.0 and Hadoop after 2.0. Right. So if it is a before 2.0,
it is name node and basically job.
Right. We have a name node and then secondary name node.
Secondary name node. Yeah,
then job tracker.
Job tracker.
Right, so Hadoop before 2.0 in a cluster we used to have only one name node, right? We don't have the multiple name nodes, it's only the one name node, right? So in Hadoop after 2.0, so what are the master nodes?
Name node and the yarn.
No, name node will have then again a secondary name
second,
node, then we'll have some extra node that we call it as a HA node, and a Hive server if you are working with Hive, and HBase server or HBase master we can configure, right? So these are all the we can configure this as the master. After that job tracker or the resource manager, right? So these are all comes into the master nodes, job tracker or yard. Okay,
so and it can include pig as well. If pig will be, pig server will be there.
No, the pig concept is different. We don't run pig as a pig server.
Okay.
So the Hive server and HBase, because we have a metastore concept is there in Hive. So that to store the metastore, I'm going to configure an extra node.
Okay.
So right now it's after 2.0. So these are all the masters.
Okay.
Right, so what are the slaves now?
Basically data node.
Right, and slaves are the data node we have, and
task tracker.
Are task
Yeah, tracker.
at the node manager, you can have a task tracker, right? Or you can have a node manager,
Node
right? Task
manager,
tracker and the node manager
node manager.
with that comes the slaves in the node. Then the Hive client, so you can write HBase region server. These are all comes into the slaves.
Okay.
Okay, so now, so Hadoop is like, you know, we can call it like this. So in this one again we can classify, right? So what are the Hadoop can be again classified into? When we are working, when the architecture level, we discuss this way, right? Master and slave. But when we are going to when we are working, so we always discuss like Hadoop is, it's like SDFS. So what are the SDFS now? SDFS daemons.
SDFS daemons.
Right. So it's like you can say Hadoop processes.
Mm-hmm.
You can say these are the Hadoop daemons, right? Which are responsible Hadoop. So that
correct,
is
correct.
That's in the form of SDFS and MapRed.
MapReduce.
Or SDFS and YARN. Right. So what are the SDFS daemons? Now we can say the name node and data nodes.
Data node.
And secondary name node, HA node. So these are all the, we have SDFS, right? So what are the MapReduce processes? It's a job tracker and task tracker. If you are using YARN, then same, resource manager and node manager. So these are the YARN daemons. So in a cluster, Hadoop is running, means SDFS and MapReduce both are running, or SDFS and YARN is running. In a cluster, only SDFS is running. Only SDFS is running.
Okay.
But it means you have started only name node,
data
node, right?
Data node.
Right. There is no MapReduce. So now to start the MapReduce means you have to start the job tracker and task tracker.
Task
you have started the YARN means you have to start the resource manager and node manager.
I just have one question. When we start the DFS, that only start SDFS.
Yes.
Okay.
Right, because the thing is, if you, we won't use this start DFS because we have the scripts, but so we won't use, because when you are using Hadoop from the cloud era, then our Hadoop in the Hortonworks are in the mapper. Did you observe when you start the Hadoop? A cluster means by default these are going to be started, right?
It automatically going to be started. But if we want to start from the Linux installation, for example, if I want to install on the Linux as a Hadoop on the top of the Linux, if I'm installing Hadoop, so I will have to start DFS individually, right?
If you are using Hadoop from the Apache, so we have
Apache,
so we have to manually start the thing.
Start.
But if the Hadoop you are using a cloud era, by default cloud era manager, or if you are using Hadoop in Hortonworks, then Ambari, or if you are using a mapper, then mapper CLI. So these are the admin tools. By default they will start the Hadoop. So we know we need to bother about this starting and stopping the cluster.
Sure. Okay.
Okay. Right. I'll give you the difference here between these Hadoop distributions. Right. Now you're clear with, right? So Hadoop before 2.0 and Hadoop after 2.0.
Correct.
Right. So now if your job is running with a YARN, yes, that is now you can see this job status in a YARN cluster. If you are running with a MapReduce, now we can see the job status in
job
a
tracker.
Job tracker, right?
Job tracker.
So this we should clearly know this. So it's up to you. Right, generally you're writing a program. We have a property MapReduce.framework.local. If you say the classic, then it goes to the job tracker. If you give YARN, then the job is run in the MapReduce. That we'll see in the upcoming sessions. Right, the thing. Okay, now you're clear with this. Any confusions here?
No, it's clear. Like it now, till now it is very much clear.
Fine. Right. So. Now, if you're running a job, right? So that means you're running a MapReduce job, or you're going to run job in YARN. okay,
Yeah.
so fine. So the second,
Shall I install Cloudera in my VirtualBox?
yes,
Okay.
right. So with the, what is your system RAM?
It's 8 GB.
Right, so you can go with the CDH 4.4.0 or
Yeah, yeah.
4.7.0 or 5 point something. I'll give you a mail how to
Yeah, yeah,
configure, how
sure.
to open your system. Just go through that one, okay?
Yeah, yeah, sure. That I know. Actually, I have then I have that copy of the Cloudera. I was installing it in my virtual box, but it was something giving some error. So I'll see
Okay,
like if
yes, I'll assist you. Take a photo and send it to me. Right, see now, see here, we are having SDFS. See, okay,
correct.
this is we'll see through Cloudera manager. See here, sub it different, right? Suppose if you are using a Cloudera, so the Hadoop distribution, right, in the Cloudera they are giving her we have SDFS available where we are going to store the data, the development part and processing, and the admin we use Cloudera manager. Do you know the admin part?
Yeah, a bit of like I have used, but I have used mostly in Hortonworks only. Like Ambari I was looking on, and a few days back like I was looking for Hadoop admin like in 1 month back, so I just have a glance of how that it is. There are something is something site on that the port on which we can configure the Ambari, and from Ambari I was looking.
Okay, right, so we have the Hortonworks. In the Hortonworks we are same, we have the SDFS, and to admin the Hortonworks we have a component that is Ambari,
Ambari.
Right, so if you are using Hadoop from the mapper, then so mapper is doesn't have SDFS, right? So they are not using the SDFS, so it's a complete, it's a little bit different work with Hadoop. So they are using the mapper file system where we are going to store the data. So here we don't have SDFS. Now it's a combination of mapper file system and yarn, right? So where we are going to work with the data in the mapper file system, so the admin part we have MCL.
Okay,
MCL is a mapper control, MCS, it's a mapper control system,
system. Okay,
right, so this is a difference.
So in replacement of SDFS, MapperFS is something which is different from SDFS?
Yes, they are using mapper, they are not using SDFS because they want to be more secure environment and they have not really done SDFS, but the mapper they have completely really done the Linux file system. So
okay.
It's a mapper, right? Sometime in our session we'll see that MapReduce 2, sorry,
okay.
mapper Hadoop 2. I'll give you the brief about how to go with the mapper control system, what is mapper CLI.
Sure.
Okay, right, so this is the difference. So if you are using Cloudera, so you'll get the Cloudera manager. If you are using Hadoop in Hortonworks, you can use mapper, right? It's an Ambari, right? Okay, so we have this cluster like this. Now if a client using Hadoop means is not completely migrating from his existing infrastructure, correct? Correct?
Correct.
So every client and every project will have a 3-tier architecture, right? So like there you have a client and a server is available and the database is available.
Correct.
Right, so the client will connect to the server as well as database also connected to the server. So the processing is done in a
3-tier architecture.
Server, the processing is done in a server.
Server, correct.
So means what? The data first get to you need to get the data to the server, and you should the client will instantiate a program. So the processing is done in the server. So right, this
server.
Is the what we have seen the architecture 3-tier. Architecture, either
correct.
You're in your BTech project or you're working
correct.
For your client, so most probably everybody will work on this environment, correct?
Okay.
Now so from the last couple of years Right now, every client is going to implement Hadoop. Some projects are migrating to the Hadoop, or some projects are they are using Hadoop for this for project. Right. So here, the difference is Hadoop supports commodity hardware. So what is a commodity hardware?
Basically, it is something which is used, like it is a hard disk of the laptop. I can use laptop as my
No, no.
node.
No, Abhishek, right? So commodity hardware in the sense, so they are the inexpensive storage machines. They are not saying you to go and buy the
enterprise data.
Right, expensive storage machines. So you can go and buy the inexpensive. We can clearly differentiate between a Micromax mobile and an iPhone, right? It's a Micromax,
correct,
right? You can expect the failure whenever it's a lifetime, right? So you can see max, right?
Correct.
But if you buy an iPhone 6, it's an expensive, but it's
correct,
at the
correct.
Long run. So we never think that this is going to be failure in recently, right? So it gives a long time, right?
Correct, correct.
The same thing now,
correct.
The commodity hardware is saying that inexpensive. They are suggesting
correct,
you
correct.
Go and buy the Micromax. Let it goes
mm-hmm.
down, let it goes down, no issue. It doesn't make any sense. It doesn't make any issue when in your job processing. So we are always
correct,
suggesting
correct.
You to go and buy the inexpensive storage machines, right?
Correct.
So why every client is looking to implement Hadoop, right? See, here I'll add a little bit. See, the thing is, first we have the big data, correct?
Yep.
So we are going to apply the big data analytics. That is, you can use SAP HANA, or you can use Oracle Exadata, right? Or you can use Teradata, or you can use Hadoop, correct? So if it is SAP HANA, you have to buy the hardware, which is much costlier.
Correct.
Then you have to
data.
Yes, you have to buy the license.
Yeah,
no, first you have to application engine, the programming part, you need
correct.
To buy that. Then you have to buy the license.
Yes, correct.
Then you have to pay for the
support.
Right.
Actually, so I work for SAP HANA also.
Right.
Sometime.
Right. So you here you are having HANA appliances, correct?
Yeah, yeah.
So we
correct,
are working
correct.
On HANA appliances. So a client has to
correct.
Buy the hardware, then he has to buy
correct.
The application engine, then he has to buy the Linux, buy support, license and support. See, when you talk
correct,
about
correct.
The client, right? Suppose you are a project manager, and see you want to, you say that you want to introduce some new project. So first client will prefer the two things. The first one is a client always talks about in the sense of the implementation cost, right? For a client, the priority is cost, correct or not?
Yeah, correct, correct.
Right, a client always talks in the sense of cost and high availability, right? It should be available all the time. Cost and
yeah,
high availability, right?
Correct.
So when you're going to SAP HANA, right? So you have to buy this everything. The cost.
Correct, correct.
Now it's same for the Oracle Exadata and the same for the Teradata. Means
Teradata.
That is you're a business, you're working with the big data, means you have the clients and you're a client to SAP then. Correct?
Correct.
Right? So you have the project, means you're using SAP HANA, you have the clients and again you're a client.
Yeah, correct.
Right. Now see, right? So why everyone is preferred to implement Hadoop, right? Why we are having this many number of projects in Hadoop? Right, Hadoop supports commodity hardware.
Correct.
Right, so what is a commodity hardware? Commodity hardware in the sense they are the inexpensive storage machines. The two things, you want to have an infrastructure or you don't want to have the infrastructure. Right, if you want to have own a dedicated infrastructure for the Hadoop, you go and buy the inexpensive storage machines. First thing, you don't, if you don't want to buy the infrastructure. Right, if you don't want to buy the infrastructure, see here, Hadoop can be integrated
web services, AWS.
Any existing infrastructure.
Oh, okay.
Hadoop can be integrated anywhere, existing infrastructure. In the sense, I'll tell you in one word, we can run Hadoop as a service.
Yeah.
Right,
okay.
So when you're going
correct.
To run a Hadoop as a service, now we can use Hadoop in SAP HANA too, we can use Hadoop in Oracle Exadata too, or you can use Hadoop in a Teradata, or you can run Hadoop as an individual machine, or your existing client, existing project, you can integrate Hadoop. So
okay.
Now you're not buying the infrastructure. Suppose you say, even I don't want to use any kind of infrastructure because I don't want to disturb my current infrastructure to implement Hadoop, right? I don't want to use existing one. Then you can run Hadoop in a cloud. right? Render storage, dump the Hadoop, dump the data, then configure Hadoop, then start running the jobs. No investment of the infrastructure now. Right? It is a commodity hardware. One is you can use existing infrastructure, or you go and buy the inexpensive, cheap machines to store the data. Otherwise, you don't want to go for the new infrastructure, configure it in existing infrastructure. You don't want to confuse with this one, then simply take a cloud, rent a storage, and start working with the Hadoop. So it's a commodity hardware. Now see how much you're investing in the hardware section. It's very little, right? If you are going for existing infrastructure, so where will be the investment? No, right? Right. So hardware part, okay. Now coming to the application engine, right? So it's a costlier HANA appliances, Oracle Exadata appliances, Teradata 7 Teradata appliances. You need to buy. It's much very much costlier. Now see Hadoop. C language, open source, freeware, C++, open source, freeware, Java, open source, freeware, Python, open source, freeware. You says that I don't want to train my employees again, right? So why should? Then you can use the existing employees who know C++, Java, Python or the .NET. Otherwise, you want to learn Hadoop, right? You say, Ajay, I'm new to the programming, so how to use Hadoop? Then Hadoop is providing two things, Hive and Pig, which are free and open source, right? So now use this programming language as an application engine to work with Hadoop. Where you're investing now, see, the cost for the application is, it's zero.
Zero.
Right?
Yeah.
So there is no, right, you're investing on the application engine. Fine. Then coming to the license provided by the whom? Apache.
Apache free.
It's a free and it's open source.
Open source.
Right now I can use Hadoop anywhere. Right. So there is no concept of duplicate and piracy. Right. Everybody, anyone can able to use Hadoop now. Right. It's a free and open source. Right. So then the support, the main thing is support. Right, but support, when it is come to the support, they are not providing the support. Apache is not providing the support. Then how to get the support? So there are the powerful public forums are there, or you can use Jira to get the support for the issues. There are the people like me will assist you all the time on your issues. That's it. Okay, so in this way how to get the support. But see, dedicated a client you're having, so you have to 200 node cluster you need to configure. You're looking for a dedicated infrastructure, right? You are having a support team. So in that one, you need a support, right? So in that case, buy the Hadoop. Okay? In that case, buy the Hadoop. Right? When you're buying the Hadoop, then buy it from the Cloudera, or you can buy the Hortonworks, or you can buy it from the Mapper. So here, it's simple. The movie is the same. But these are the theaters, as you can say, only the theaters, right? So when it comes to the theaters, where the difference comes, the environment which they are providing, the pricing, the features which they are providing is the different. But the movie which you are playing is the same. It's a Hadoop same. From the Apache. So it's in a Cloudera or it's in a Hortonworks, it's in a Mapper. But we are writing a Hive, same. We are writing the big, the application engine, what we said, it is the same thing, right? So there is no change. The change comes into the features they are providing. The change is available in the pricing is available, right? So here you can find the difference. That's it. So in that case, you can buy the Hadoop. So this is the reason why the Hadoop jobs are, why every client is trying to implement the Hadoop. Because you're going to get the much benefit with this. Right, in tomorrow's session I'll teach you that. So why, how they use Hadoop, right? I'll give you one example of some data, then why, what are the big data, what are the big data analytics, right? So how the a client is going to get benefit, those things we'll see in the next session. Okay,
next session. Fine.
Right, so now, right, so they have, this is a right, application engine. So why every client is preferred to use Hadoop. So now if a client is trying to implement the Hadoop, so it's not completely migrating,
Yeah, it
So,
is simply
yeah, so it's an added
data, it is
infrastructure. It's
nothing.
an existing infrastructure at the added infrastructure. Now, see here, suppose you are having your production database like this, right? In your production database, you can see you are using MySQL here.
Correct.
Okay, so suppose every day you are getting 500 GB data to your production database. But how much it, if you want to run a query by targeting 500 GB data, it's a lot of time to process. You need to spend hours of the time. So
Absolutely.
in a month, it's you are going to generate 15 terabytes of data. If it is a 500 GB on every day, means in a 30 days you'll get 15 TB, which it's not at all possible to analyze the data with a MySQL, right? So what you have to do now, so you need some other thing to process the data. So now what we are doing now, so we have a component called SQube. Okay, so we are using SQube. So with this SQube, we are importing the data from the production database to the Hadoop cluster.
Hello, Mr.
Right, so now we get the data to the Hadoop cluster to process the data. Clear enough? So it's a one component which will performs importing and exporting the data both the ways, right? I can get the data and I can process it. After that, I can able to send the data back to the production database. Both the ways we can able to work, import and export with the SQL. That's the one thing. But not all the clients will have the database, right? So you can say
Correct.
YouTube, Facebook, Twitter, because maintaining for them database, because they have a bulk amount of data. So what they will do
Correct.
now, they have the data is in a network attached storage, right? They are using NAS, right? NAS is network attached storages, or you can say the scribe middle tiers, right? Now the data is available in this storage servers. Now what I'm going to do is I'm configuring an agent, right? I'm going to configure an agent. So this agent, I'll say him to reside in the server. Okay, so this agent, where he'll reside? He'll reside in the server. So when the data is available in the server, so this agent will collect the data from the server and he syncs the data into the Hadoop cluster, right? So we call him as an agent. Agent is a program. So we are going to configure this agent in a component called Flume. Okay, Flume is one component, right? So we are going to configure an agent and we specify this agent to reside in the server when the data is available, when the data is traveling. So it will sync a copy to the Hadoop cluster. Got it? Now that's a Flume. After that, right, we get the data to the Hadoop cluster. Okay,
Fine.
right? Otherwise, you have the data in the Linux file system. Now you can copy the data from Linux file, existing file system to the SDFS. This is one way we are getting the data. Correct?
Correct.
Otherwise, suppose I'm having some other disk. Okay, so it's a my disk, some hard disk, and I can configure an FTP. Right, like you can use FinSCP kind of tools to send the data to the Hadoop cluster, right? So these are the different ways we are getting the data, different ways. Okay, right, you can use SQube or Flume or FTP, or you can copy the files from the local file system, right? So we are getting the data to the Hadoop cluster, right? After that, what you're doing now, so you are going to process this data. Once the data is available, you are going to process it with Hive and Pig. Okay, that's you are using MapReducer yarn to process the data. Okay, so after data process completed, then what you will do? So if your client asked how many customers purchased products today, so did you send the output of the Hive directly to your client? No, correct? You have to generate the beautiful picture representation, graphical
Correct,
representation,
correct,
right? So
correct,
here,
correct.
so once the processing is completed, now we use visualization tools
Visualization tools.
to generate the visualizations, right? So now we'll send the data to Hive to visualization tools. Right here you can
Correct.
use W, right?
Tableau, Business
Or you can
Operation.
use QuickView, right? Or you can use Hunk, or you can use Pendo reports, you can use Jasper reports, Zoom charts, right? So we have the different visualization tools are there, right? So you can use this, you can use an Excel here, right? So different visualization tools are there. So you can use these visualization tools. Okay, right. So fine, you have generated the report. After that, what you will do? You have to store the output. Where you want to store the output? You want to send it back to the production database. But if your data is structured, then you can able to store the data back to the DBMS. If your data is unstructured, then how to store the data into the Hadoop cluster itself, right? I want to store the data into Hadoop cluster. So then whenever you want to store the data into Hadoop cluster, now we have a NoSQL is available, right? Now here, so once the processing is completed, otherwise you can directly store the data from the SDFS to the NoSQL. Okay, otherwise you can get the data from the Hiveorpic Java to the NoSQL. Right, here in the NoSQL, what we have? We can use
Kind of
HBase,
column HBase,
or you can
Cassandra.
use MongoDB, or Cassandra, right, CouchDB, DynamoDB, right? So different NoSQLs are available. Right, now we can able to store the data as part of the NoSQL. Got it now? So as a Hadoop developer, now your job role comes into the data collection team, where you have to collect different ways to collect the data into the Hadoop cluster, or you are in a data processing team to process the data, right? It's a role of Hadoop developer. Now if your job role is a Hadoop analyst, then you have to work with the data processing, and you have to work on the analytical tool, any one analytical tool, right? So that will be your job role as a Hadoop analyst, right? It's the difference between a Hadoop developer and Hadoop analyst. So when you're a Hadoop analyst, you should be able to use any one component here, right? After that, so how much you are being a Hadoop developer? Suppose you are a Java developer, correct? So how much SQL you should know? You should know DDL, DML commands, something programmatically, then that will be given to the PaleSQL programmer, right? So, but do you write the PaleSQL program? We won't write. It will be given to the PaleSQL program. Please get the code for this one. So they will write a code and they'll give it to you, correct? So the but basically what we should know, how to create the table, how to update, how to CRUD, DDL, DML commands, we should know that to connect, right? The same thing as a Hadoop developer, we should know the CRUD operations. Right, the CRUD in the sense create, read, update, and delete. Right, so as a Hadoop developer, you should know this, and there will be separate developer for HBase developer, MongoDB developer, Cassandra developer. They are separate. Now they will give you the complete coding that will be assigned to the individual NoSQL developers. But as a Hadoop developer, we should know the CRUD in HBase, CRUD in MongoDB, CRUD in Cassandra, how to perform these CRUD operations. Okay, now the entire cluster is configured by the Hadoop admin, right? Taking the systems, configuring, it should identify what are the Hadoop processes running, which one is down. If the cluster is running slow, why? If the job is running slow, why? Right? So you're collecting the job from the Flume, but it's taking a lot of time to collect data, then why? That these are the things done by the Hadoop admin. Okay, right? So after that, Hadoop developer, Hadoop admin, Hadoop analyst, then individual HBase developers. After that, we have a data science, right? What is a data science? Now you want to implement a new product. Suppose this week, so Walmart is giving some extra discount for specific users. How much they are going to get the benefit? Who will calculate that? The data science team will calculate that, right? The feasibility, the benefit to the client as well as the benefit to the customer. So for that, you should be a good mathematics. You should be good in the mathematics. And after that, generally the people from the IIT is preferred for the data science, because they see, can see much people are saying that we are giving to gain, give the training and the data science, but it's never suits for everybody, data science, right? Specifically, it should be very much in the good in the mathematics, right? Only those none. If I ask you what is the integration of x to the power of n, what it is, Abhishek?
Yeah, x to the power of n, it is something x multiply times multiply by n.
X to the power of n plus 1 by n plus 1, right? So that's,
okay,
if you can
yeah.
able to do this, if you say the sine 30 is 0.5, that much faster, right? For them, particularly the people from the statistical background will be preferred to the data science. So it's not suitable for everyone, but the people, because this is a commercial people, they will train, but the, when it's coming to the job, that never, the client never prefers to take everyone, because it's because the new implementation, right, the feasibility, it's done by the data science, so they don't want to do the experiment with that one, right? So it's a data science one job role. So these are the different job roles are available in the Hadoop. Got it now? So today I've teach you, right, so what are the Hadoop we have, what are the Hadoop domains, why Hadoop jobs, right, why, what will be the different job roles in Hadoop,
correct,
right? So this is what we have discussed in today's session.